Aloha, welcome to ThinkTech Hawaii's Movers, Shakers, and Reformers, Politics in Hawaii series. I'm your host, Carl Campagna. Today, we're going to be talking about Native Hawaiian issues. There are a lot of Native Hawaiian issues to be really addressed, that need to be addressed really in full, and it goes back to a long, long history. I'm not going to pretend that I know all of the history, but I do know some of it. I'm aware of some of it. So we have sovereignty issues. We have local issues here that deal with education. We have protests issues. We have land issues, which is related to sovereignty, but has obviously different capacities and different areas of that, including TMT. There's a lot of really areas to talk about. Today, we're going to focus in a little bit on a couple of those areas, but I will invite you to join us and my guest today, Mr. Ikaika Hussey. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Carl.
Ikaika is a number of things, actually, and I want him to tell us a bit about him, but partially one of the things is he's a member of the Hawaiian Alliance for Progressive Action. So congratulations for that, and thank you for joining the show. And tell us a bit about yourself and where you are politically with HAPA, where you are Native Hawaiian side.
Sure. So I've been involved in the Hawaiian sovereignty movement for about, at this point, let's see, 20 years. I think almost exactly 20 years.
Wow.
I got involved right after I graduated from high school. And it was a really interesting time. It was the mid-90s, a time when questions around Hawaiian sovereignty and governance were literally on the front page, like every day. And
what school did you go to?
I went to Iolani myself, which I'm very proud of, the same school that Prince Kuhio went to for a number of years, among other people who are interesting, Mufi Hanuman, et cetera.
That's right.
But so I grew up during a time when Hawaiian sovereignty was something that everyone was talking about. And I decided that I wanted to be involved deeply in how the conversation was going. I had concerns about some of the things that were being said, and I thought, I need to be involved.
Yeah. Okay, so that's did that begin your, I guess, entry into the political realm?
It did. Yeah, really did.
Okay. And that has persisted, as we know. You know, for, again, congratulations, you ran for state house last year.
It's persisted, yes.
It has persisted, which is good. Okay, now tell us about HAPA, the Hawaiian Alliance for Progressive Action. What is that?
Okay, so it's a relatively new organization, but it's incredibly effective. Established by Gary Hooser and some other progressives, it's essentially a coalition bringing together and helping to provide a kind of a gathering place for a lot of progressive organizations to come together and organize together. And so we've done, for instance, the Kuleana Academy, which has trained some wonderful leaders to take new roles in our state and local politics. We convened the People's Congress in the last fall or last winter. And we also have, in fact, just last weekend, we brought together a group of activists and leaders on the island of Kauai, people who are farmers and fishermen, policymakers, talking about the very concrete, I should say, non-concrete things that need to be done on the island of Kauai around water and land use. So we're very engaged in the community. And
in the environment and in culture.
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, because they all kind of have to tie together.
Sure, I mean, culture is the way we look at things, right?
Right.
It's the lens through which we see everything around us, absolutely.
Right, and that culture gets shifted and adjusted based on our neighbor cultures, based on who our neighbors literally are, not just the countries nearest us, but also the person who lives next to us.
Sure.
And how we have to accommodate, and how many of us are multicultural.
Right.
As well, and that's another issue that comes in, how that stuff gets addressed. Mm-hmm. Specifically, again, trying to stick with Native Hawaiian theme. It is interesting, I don't have the exact percentage of Native Hawaiians population-wise, maybe you have the number.
It's about 500,000. I'm not a census expert.
About 500, roughly. From my understanding, the Filipino community is the largest single community represented within Hawaii.
Yeah, I should say, I'm sorry, 500,000 Hawaiians worldwide.
Worldwide,
okay. Yeah.
Okay, yeah, because we only have 1.2 million people in Hawaii.
Correct.
So. Okay, but that's one of the issues and concerns we have here in Hawaii, as far as, okay, Native Hawaiian rights, sovereignty. Mm-hmm. So let's dig into sovereignty a little bit more. Tell me, give me a summary, if you would, of your experience at the very least, and some background with some sovereignty issues that are happening even today.
Sure. Well, I'm going to avoid recapitulating the entire.
Yeah, we don't.
We're not going to start with 1893 forward. Yeah. But I'll sort of give a kind of a framework for context.
Yeah.
The discussion right now runs between two poles, I would say. One pole is let's continue with politics as usual, and the prevailing political economy of Hawaii, which is overwhelmingly tourist-based and construction-based, military-based, and try to address Native Hawaiian land and sovereignty claims within that structure of
self-governance within the structure.
Right, within the structure of American, you know, of what I would call American imperialism and militarism, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The other way to do it, which is the frame that I prefer personally, is to flip it and to say, okay, the Hawaiian problem, the Hawaiian question, is really just the flip side of the question about Americanism and militarism in Hawaii. And so I would prefer to address that as the issue, as the problem, and to look at how do we reconstitute our sense of what Hawaii is and what Hawaii can be, right, within the framework of a multicultural, progressive, inclusive society that is grounded on, you know, a very long, multi-thousand-year history of Hawaiian culture in Hawaii, and that has been enriched by all of the other cultures and ethnicities that have come to make Hawaii their home. So I would look at it in terms of how do we create a more progressive and inclusive society grounded in a Hawaiian sense of place and being.
So it's more of like a, from what direction you're coming.
Yeah.
Are you coming from American or are you coming from Hawaiian?
Right.
So if this is Hawaii first, America second, is that...
In the age of Trump, I'm trying to avoid the use of the word first.
Okay.
However, I do believe
probably
that...
Probably a good idea.
I do believe that, like, when people say the word mainland, I like to pause and say, well, you know,
who's
I think
mainland?
That here for the people of Hawaii and all of the kids of Hawaii and the kupuna of Hawaii, Hawaii should be our mainland.
Yes.
And we should treat it as if it is our home. I don't think we should actually treat it as if it's paradise. I prefer to think of it as homeland.
Yeah.
You know, if this is our home, we should do certain things. We should make sure that the people are healthy. We should make sure that the land is healthy, that the water is flowing, and that the people are able to succeed in our home.
Or even have access,
right,
to the lands and to, right, the water. Because there are land and water rights that are challenges that now.
Sure.
That have been challenges for decades, actually.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at like the issue of Red Hill, for instance.
Yes.
The Red Hill tanks, right? They're underground, there's like 20 storage tanks. And
huge storage,
right,
tanks.
Huge
gigantic
storage tanks.
Ones, yeah.
There's been releases of fuel into the aquifer. Mm-hmm. And there's a concern that if there were more releases, that it would affect the drinking water, not just of the people right around Red Hill, but really, I don't know, 800,000 people who live along all of South Oahu.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly. And that is because it's recognizing there are, I believe there are two aquifers that supply the fresh water for Oahu.
It's actually more than two, I think, but it is.
There's the one primary that handles, really, as you mentioned, the whole,
yeah,
I guess, southern
where
shore.
Where everybody lives.
And then from the, where a majority of the people,
right,
live, exactly. So you can't talk about, yeah, and that's a big concern, actually. I don't want to, that could be a show into itself, actually, but
yeah,
that is a big concern. So,
but,
okay, tell me about the Hawaiian side.
Well, I would think of it not just as a Hawaiian side, but really the way that we as the people of Hawaii, the locals, the,
yeah,
residents, whatever term, we should probably find a new word, actually, to,
yeah,
describe this this idea, but the people of Hawaii should look at that problem, at least the way that I look at it, is that this is something that's going to affect everybody. We need to address this, not because it's a Hawaiian issue or because,
right,
it's an environmental issue, but because this is something that's going to affect all of us.
Absolutely.
So we need to, you know, close down those tanks, get the oil out of our ground,
mm-hmm,
and out of our water.
Yeah, well, as much as can be, because,
yeah,
I know that ends up being a larger issue. How do you dig it all up to get it all out? And what are those impacts then,
right,
becomes it? But I know that's again, that could be a whole show in,
sure,
itself, the whole Red Hill thing. But okay, so again, now that brings me just back to that main thought again. It's about not just direction of where you're coming from, but it's how you're perceiving it, how you're beginning your conversation,
mm-hmm,
how you're recognizing we live in Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
We need to think about the people of Hawaii, and yes, there's Native Hawaiians, but there's many other groups and cultures.
Mm-hmm.
what happens environmentally impacts everyone who's here.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so therefore, you're looking at the perspective, I'm summarizing, and please correct me. You're looking at the perspective of what is Hawaiian to be representative of a thought process and of an inclusiveness in that regard.
I suppose, I guess that the way that I would say it is that I think that there's a lot of ways in which the Hawaiian interest is actually the same interest as the local Japanese interest and the local Chinese interest.
Well, it's because
the
we're
local
here.
Filipino interest, right.
Because we're all here.
Right, we're the people who are here.
Right.
We're going to be, you know, doing business together, going to church together,
right.
Driving on the same roads together, hopefully riding on the same rail together.
You know, eventually.
Having families together.
Yeah.
We're one people
right.
in a lot of ways. We have different ways of entering into Hawaii.
Yeah.
You know, different ways that we become part of this place.
Different things that brought us here.
Yeah. But we, at the end of the day, we're all here together, so we need to work together to make sure that
right.
this place is
now,
successful.
That, I believe a lot of people would like to hear that idea, as opposed to, the, I think, the other side of some of the sovereignty statements that have been made, which is all of you non-Native Hawaiians need to leave the islands, need to go away.
Mm.
I hear that sometimes too, and you understand it. You know, when you look at the history of it, again, not relitigating the whole thing, but when you look at it and you understand it from a perspective of what happened historically. So how what is your thought process with regards to we're all here now, let's move forward together versus, you know what, most of you shouldn't be here anyway, which I know is one of the, I don't know how large or small that faction is, but one of the, I guess, desires from some of the people, some of the Native Hawaiians, or some of them are actually not Native Hawaiians, but still believe that this to be true.
Yeah,
as I've learned. So, what's your thought on those?
I would say that in every ethnic group, there are essentially people who are not, they don't want to get along, you know. And you see that in the Hawaiian community, you see that in the African American community. There's racists everywhere,
mm-hmm.
And I think we need to call it what it is.
Yeah.
There's historical reasons for those perspectives. There's political reasons for those perspectives. But I don't think that that's a very productive politics, and it's not going to help us move forward.
Yeah, no, I think that that's, your point is very valuable as far as it's not productive policy for what we're doing today and how we're moving forward.
Yeah, and the thing is, I think it, I mean, I can only speak for myself, right? And I can tell you my personal vantage point, which is growing up in a family where really the predominant identity was that we were Catholic. And it wasn't that we were Hawaiian or Filipino or part English or part Irish and et cetera. And it was really that we were a Catholic family. That was our main thing that we did as a family.
Yeah.
We just happened to be Hawaiian and Filipino and Irish and all these other things.
So it's a different base.
It's a different base.
Yeah.
And I've always had the perspective that I wanted to live under the same set of laws and the same, within the same community as like my mom and her family, which is a local Filipino family.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a Caucasian wife and I have mixed children, but we all, you know, we all do hula and we all learn olelo,
yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
We all believe that the land itself is sacred.
Right.
And yeah. I think that's a belief that in spite of Mayor Arakawa, on Maui,
yeah.
I think that's actually something that a lot of people get behind.
I think there's truth in that. And I think there's truth in that in throughout Hawaii, at least, you know, from what I've heard here or there. But also I think there's truth in that, not just nationally, but globally when it comes to that. But it's about how we do that. So we have to take a quick break.
Okay.
So we're already there. And then we'll jump back. So again, thank you for joining us. ThinkTech Hawaii's Movers, Shakers, and Reformers, Politics in Hawaii series. Thank you to my guest today, Mr. Ikaika Hussey. We'll see you in 1 minute. Thank you.
And thanks for watching ThinkTech Hawaii. My name is Justine Espiritu, and I host the Hawaii Food and Farmer Series with my co-host Matthew Johnson of Oahu Fresh. Every week, we bring on farmers as well as all the other individuals and organizations that help support a thriving, sustainable food system. In fact, it's interesting to learn what others are doing, so you don't have to be a Hawaii resident or producing food on Hawaii to be featured on the show, like today's guest, Wyatt Bryson of Jewels of the Forest and Michael Lab Solutions.
Aloha, thank you. It's been a pleasure being on the show. I love seeing what you guys do, and I really support your mission. And it's really nice being back in Hawaii, and thank you again. It's an honor.
So you can see guests like Wyatt every Thursday at 4 p.m. on ThinkTech Hawaii. Thank you.
Welcome back to ThinkTech Hawaii's Movers, Shakers, and Reformers, Politics in Hawaii series. Again, I'm the host, Carl Campagna. My guest today is Mr. Ikaika Hussey. We are talking about as many issues as we can talk about with regards to Native Hawaiian concerns and going forward from today. So again, thanks for joining us. So we were just talking off air a little bit about some of the challenges that come up with regards to blood quantum and people talking to other people about whether they should be here. So you had a comment. I want to jump in.
Which is that I think a lot of Hawaiians enter into conversations with non-Hawaiians or with themselves with the belief that Hawaiians are sort of on the losing side of history. And I think that that's wrong. And I have a couple of reasons for thinking that. One is that compared to the situation of most other Native peoples, both on the U.S. continent, in places like Africa, et cetera, we're doing incredibly well. You know, we have very powerful institutions. We have a lot of land actually controlled by institutions like Kamehameha Schools or the Queen's Trust. There's a large number of Hawaiians who are strongly middle class and are very successful in their professions, in their businesses. We have the largest indigenous language archive in the world, mm-hmm. Through our newspapers and the work of people like Puakea Nogamaya, who have helped to bring us along into looking at those archives.
I think I'd like to jump in and say that actually is a perfect transition to the next segment I want to talk about, which
sure.
is if we're looking at it from that perspective, saying that, and I can agree with the points that you're making and several others, that actually, Native Hawaiians are actually doing fairly well as far as the culture. There's a number of reasons for that, I suppose, as well. But doing well, in what measure? In what way are we going to measure that? And one thing I want to talk about now is education. So I was able to attend an event last night at Kamehameha Schools, where my son goes, and we were talking earlier about this, where we learned the school is taking a new approach, and they want new outcomes for the kids going to Kamehameha Schools. It all sounds wonderful. It all sounds great. But some of the statistics that we got last night was, perhaps at this moment or at any given time, they refer to being approximately 152,000 Native Hawaiian kids between the age of 0 and 24. Mm-hmm. Of those kids, we traditionally see year after year about 52% of those Native Hawaiian kids are prepared for kindergarten.
In other words, 48% are not prepared.
48% are not prepared for kindergarten. And they're not talking about Kamehameha Schools kindergarten. They're not talking about public schools.
Right.
They're not separate. They're saying in general,
uh-huh.
all schools, charter schools, immersion schools. 48% are not prepared. 52% are.
I mean, the preponderance of those numbers would really be, the larger percentage is really not charter schools or immersion schools. It's really standard DOE,
right? Yes, absolutely. And that gets, as they went further into those numbers as well, and in other categories, you see the stark difference between how the kids perform through Kamehameha schools and some of their charter schools compared to public schools. So one of the next statistics is 25% of Native Hawaiians graduate high school.
Mm-hmm.
So again, we're talking 152,000, 25% of them will graduate high school. And only 14% will graduate from a college. Now, that descending track there would probably be, to some degree, consistent maybe across multiple cultures, in multiple areas, multiple parts of various countries maybe, as you see, okay, everybody starts here, and then for various reasons, things tail down. However, I find that to be an alarming number. Only 14% of Native Hawaiians are graduating from university,
yeah.
either a two-year or a four-year. I don't know, let me get your thought on that before I jump into the next thing. So as far as that sort of descending scale and only 14%,
right, and so many jobs in Hawaii nowadays require a college degree.
Exactly, sure. We were talking earlier. Right. Technically, the number that we were given last night was 65% of the jobs that are available in Hawaii require a college degree.
Right.
So if 14% of Native Hawaiians are getting a college degree and 65% of the jobs require it, there's a gap,
right.
A significant gap.
So I want to tell a counter story. Mm-hmm. It's really fascinating, I think, is that if we were to rewind the clock a bit, in the 1840s, 1850s, Hawaii went from a zero literacy community, country, to being essentially having universal literacy in the span of like 20 years, an incredible feat. Mm-hmm. And we went to having, from being no education system, or at least no formal Western recognized education system, to one where essentially everyone is educated, and we have a world-class education system. Now, you fast forward to, you know, to you talking story with folks at Kamehameha Schools last night. We're now at the very bottom of actually the worst state in the United States, right? Which
for education,
right? In terms of education, the United States is also the very worst of the industrialized countries. Mm-hmm. So, if you were to graph that, you're going from the very best on the planet to the very, 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 very worst on the planet in, I don't know how many years that is. Not very many years.
Well, 100 years.
106 years.
Yeah. Which,
right. And so,
It says a lot.
And I think we need to look at what happened in that time period.
One thing I want to add there, though, is there was, you're right, there was a point where literacy rates among Native Hawaiians was very high. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, but that was also in Native Hawaiian language. That was also in local language as well. Literacy was pretty high.
And also in English.
And in English. But then all of a sudden, in the schools and in a number of other places, the Native Hawaiian language was suddenly banned.
Well, it's not quite that simple.
Please.
And I'm not a scholar in this.
Please explain.
We've got to bring in other folks who can really
talk
about
this. Yeah, absolutely. But I just look at the whole thing as how Native Hawaiians are being impacted, and what are the consequences we're seeing? I guess that's really where I'm at. What are the consequences that we're seeing?
Right.
And what can we do from here now? Because it's not okay.
Sure. So just real briefly, towards the end of the Kingdom period, the government made a decision to use English as a language for of legal jurisprudence of legal work.
Partially because
English compared with Hawaiian is much simpler. Hawaiian is a very ornate poetic language where there are, you know, a lot of different meanings for a single word.
Right.
But in English, it's pretty cut and dry. You can get very specific in terms of the meaning, the semiotic meaning of a word. I think if you were to take that broad kind of 160 years and look at what's happened, part of that is the overthrow. It's the dispossession of Hawaiians from their own lands, the destruction or the replacing of a subsistence economy with an export-oriented monocrop economy. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's the idea that Hawaii is not the mainland anymore.
Right.
You know. So it's a broader story, I think, about a people being kind of moved away from their own center,
marginalized and moved away
in their own homeland.
Right. So how do we fix this? I mean, I'm not saying you have all the solutions, but I would like to have the conversation. I'm not beginning the conversation. I'm trying to advance that conversation. How do we begin to fix it? How do we change these education numbers? Because,
so I would say that there's a lot of people who are actually working on this problem.
Yeah.
Right. There's incredible scholars like Kuka Hakalau, who has spent, I don't know, her career developing an indigenous model for Hawaiian education that she pioneered in the charter school movement and is now doing it independently. There's people like Kalei Kuaka'eo who have been advancing the ideas about what education should look like in terms of sort of a Paulo Freire approach, you know, looking at the humanity of the students.
Mm-hmm.
There's great charter schools, and there's great teachers in the DOE as well, and in Kamehameha schools and the private schools who are working on this problem. So I don't want to be misperceived that there's a huge problem and there's no
and
one
there's no,
working.
No, no, I don't want that either. I agree. Yeah. There's a lot of people who are trying to address it in multiple levels in multiple areas.
I think we're not going to get to, we're not going to get back to the point where we have, you know, universal literacy and the world's best education system until we start to put Hawaii kind of, until we start to treat Hawaii as our source and our center.
Yeah.
You know, you look at Finland, for instance. Finland is often trumpeted as, we can't use the word trumpeted, not anymore.
Not anymore.
Held up as a model for global education. I had the privilege of speaking with an individual who was part of the Finnish Ministry of Education, Pasi Salberi. Okay. And he told me, unfortunately, off the record, but I'm going to tell it to you now. He told me that the reason why,
it's on the record now.
I asked him, why did Finland decide to make this awesome education system? And he said, they were very worried about Russia. They were worried that Russia would invade again and take over Finland again. And they decided the best means of national defense was an educated populace. Now, I want you to juxtapose that against what we're doing with education in the United States and education in Hawaii. Historically, since the plantation era, education has been two-tier. It's been colonial and plantation. You have the Punahou and the and Kamehameha to educate the ali'i and the lunas, essentially, the owners and the management of the plantation system.
Right.
And then you have the public schools, which were designed to create low-wage labor.
Yeah.
And I think we need to start treating our children as, you know, this is our best means of advancement for our entire society.
I agree. Yeah. I agree. That's why I wanted us to focus on education
right.
as a piece in this segment, because that, as the Republican administration said last night, education is the civil rights issue of our time. I don't know that. I think that it's even bigger than that, frankly, but it's at least it's being recognized in that way.
But you know, imagine if we were to really take education seriously.
Yeah.
The governor would not be pinching pennies when it comes to teacher salaries.
Exactly. If we were to give the appropriate representation towards the educators and towards the education as we recognize is the value going forward,
we would
65% of the jobs.
We would have had air conditioning in Maili
long time ago.
20 years ago when we decided that it was a problem.
Right.
Exactly. For the first time.
Exactly. So across the board, education, so Finland as an example, as a reference point, as an example, education is one of the keys. And therefore, going back to what I learned last night and from this conversation is making sure that we all get back to recognizing how we can improve our educational system for all across the board and how we can make some of these numbers better for everyone as well. Mm-hmm. So unfortunately, we're done.
Okay.
But I would love to have you come back, and we'll take another issue and dig deeper in. So thank you for joining us. This is ThinkTech Hawaii's Movers, Shakers, and Reformers. I'm your host, Carl Campagna. Thank you once again to Ikaika Hussey for joining us with the Hawaii Alliance. What is it? Hawaii Alliance
for Progressive Action.
For Progressive
HAPA,
Action.
In other words.
HAPA, yeah. And we look forward to talking with you again next week, and we'll see you soon. Thank you.